Hello everyone, welcome to my YouTube channel. Today we will discuss about OPAMP as an integrator. The topics covered in this video are how OPAMP can be used as an integrator, integrator behavior on square wave input, OPAMP integrator limitations, OPAMP integrator behavior on sine wave input, effect of input offset voltage and input bias current on integrator, how OPAMP can be used as AC integrator with DC gain control, how to reset integrator, and finally we will discuss some examples on OPAMP integrator. The ideal OPAMP integrator circuit is shown here. An integrator is basically an inverting amplifier where we replace the feedback resistor with reactive element or frequency dependent element such as capacitor. Now we have RC network connected across feedback path. In simple OPAMP, the output is proportional to input signal amplitude. The integrator OPAMP produces an output that is both proportional to amplitude and duration of input signal. We can simply say that the output of an integrator is proportional to the area of the input waveform over a period of time. When an input signal is applied to this circuit, since point A is at virtual ground, so the voltage at the inverting terminal is always 0 volt. Because of infinite input impedance of the OPAMP, the input current that flows through the R1 entirely flows through the feedback capacitor CF. So by applying KCL, we can say that Iin equal to Ic. We can write Iin as Vin minus 0 divided by Rin. That equals to Vin by Rin. Let's consider this is our equation 1. Also voltage across capacitor Vc equal to 0 minus Vout, that equal to minus Vout. Here I am showing an equivalent feedback circuit. As we know, charge across this capacitor Q is equal to C into V. So the capacitor current Ic equal to rate of change of charge with respect to time. Here the capacitance is not changing. So our expression Ic equal to C multiplied by dVc divided by dt. Here we can write capacitor current Ic equal to minus Cf multiplied by dV out divided by dt. Let's say this is our equation number 2. Now from equations 1 and 2, we can write Vin by Rin equal to minus Cf multiplied by dVo divided by dt, or we can write dv out by dt equal to minus 1 divided by rcf into vin. This is our equation number 3. To find out the output voltage, we integrate the both sides of the equation 3. Vout with respect to t equal to minus 1 divided by rcf integration of vin t multiplied by dt. This equation shows that output is integral of input with an inversion and scale multiplier 1 by RCF. Here RCF represents the integration time of the integrator circuit. Now we will discuss this with one example. Suppose a fixed input voltage 1 volt is applied to this integrator circuit. Here R1 equal to 1 mega ohm, feedback capacitor CF equal to 1 microfarad, the scale factor minus 1 by RCF equal to minus 1 divided by 1 mega ohm multiplied by 1 microfarad, that equal to minus 1. So for a fixed input voltage 1 volt, a constant current will flow through the input resistor and into the capacitor, and the capacitor voltage will increase until the OPAMP reaches the saturation. Here initially output voltage will increase in negative direction because of inverting action. And at a certain point, the output will get saturated. The rate at which the output voltage will reach the saturation will depend upon the input resistor and feedback capacitor. So by changing the values of input resistor and feedback capacitor, we can change the slope of this output signal. If R1 equal to 100 kilo ohm, then the scale factor minus 1 by RCF becomes minus 10. Then our output voltage slope is steeper than earlier. If we apply a square wave pulse as an input to the integrator circuit, the output will be a triangular wave. In such a case, the circuit is called ramp generator. During low to high level of the input square wave, the feedback capacitor gets charged. And during high to low level, the capacitor gets discharged. The charging and discharging rate depends on the resistor and capacitor combination and also on the input signal frequency. For higher frequencies, the capacitor gets very minimum time to fully charge up. Suppose if the input signal time period is T, if the T by 2 is greater than RC, which makes the output to saturate for a while. Here, consider the output voltage in negative direction. If we increase the input signal frequency, now our T by 2 gets reduced. Suppose it is equal to the value of RC, then our output waveform looks like this. This shows that it is the region where the integrator performs the well integration operation. If we further increase the input signal frequency, now our T by 2 is lesser than the value of RC. We can see that the integrator cannot efficiently follow the speed rate. So for proper integration, the frequency or periodic time of the input square wave needs to be lesser than or equal to the circuit time constant. And also we can say that the amplitude and slope of the output signal depends on the values of input resistor and feedback capacitor combination as well as input signal frequency. But in practical conditions, we might not get output which was in the theoretical calculations. There are some limitations for the simple integrated circuit. Let us write output voltage in terms of impedance. Reactance of the capacitor Xc equal to 1 by 2 pi Fc. So inverting op-amp Vout equal to minus Xc divided by Rin multiplied by Vin. Here gain equal to minus Xc divided by R. We can write gain as minus 1 divided by 2 pi RCF. From these expressions we can say that at very low frequencies or at DC level, the reactance of this capacitor is very high and acts as an open circuit. So the gain of the op-amp will be very high because the circuit acts as an open loop inverting amplifier with very high gain. This will result the saturation of the output voltage. As the input frequency increases, the reactance of this capacitor will reduce. The capacitor gets charged, but at higher frequencies, the capacitor acts like a short circuit. Because of this, the gain and output voltage will also reduce. So from this, we can say that the integrator behaves like a low pass filter. If we observe the frequency response curve of the integrator, at low frequencies, gain becomes open loop voltage gain. The open loop voltage gain of op-amp is 10 to the power of 6, which is 100 dB. As the input frequency increases, the voltage gain reduces. But in practical conditions, suppose if we are using op-amp at this frequency, then also it is quite possible that output gets saturated or distorted. This problem is caused by two non-ideal aspects, namely input offset voltage and input bias current. Because every op-amp has some sort of input offset voltage and input bias current. Even though input offset voltage of few millivolt, but steady DC current that flows through the feedback capacitor and also input bias current leads to a DC input offset current that flows through the capacitor. Any steady DC current flowing in the feedback path will create a capacitor voltage that gradually increases towards saturation. So in this way, even though you are operating at higher frequency, because of input offset voltage and input bias current that gets integrated with the feedback capacitor, integrator output will get saturated. So the solution for these limitations are quite simple. By adding a feedback resistor in parallel to the feedback capacitor, we can provide a consistent path for the DC current. Now at lower frequencies, the capacitor acts as an open circuit. So the gain of op-amp is inverting gain. That is minus Rf by Rin. Even though few millivolts of input offset voltage get multiplied by this gain, but this is much better than a gradual increase in capacitor voltage and saturation. But this adds undesirable error component to the output voltage. The feedback resistor also affects the frequency response of the integrator circuit. Unfortunately, these two side effects react in opposite way. A smaller value of feedback resistor generates lower DC error, but greater effect on the frequency response of this integrator. A larger feedback resistance generates more DC error voltage, but less effect on frequency response of the integrator circuit. So, moreover, a compensation resistor being connected to the non-inverting terminal. This resistor is to avoid input bias current. If the input of an integrator is sine wave, the output will be a cosine wave, which is 90 degrees out of phase with the input signal. In triangular wave input, the integrator produces a sinusoidal output. As the integrator acts as a low-pass filter, the high-frequency harmonics are greatly reduced. The output sine wave only consists low-frequency harmonics and the output sine wave will be of low amplitude. So, because of feedback resistance, the frequency response of the integrator acts like a low-pass filter. At lower frequencies of the input, the feedback capacitor remains uncharged and acts as an open circuit. This results the op-amp will act as an inverting op-amp and it will provide a constant gain of minus Rf by Rin. So, because of feedback resistor, the frequency response looks like this. So, let's say 3 dB frequency or a cutoff frequency of this integrator is FL. So, if the input signal frequency is lesser than this cutoff frequency, the op-amp will act as an inverting op-amp with a gain of minus Rf by Rin. So, to use the op-amp as an integrator, the input signal frequency must be larger than this cutoff frequency FL. FL can be given by the expression 1 by 2 pi Rf into Cf. If the input signal frequency increases than this cutoff frequency, the feedback capacitor gets charged and acts almost like a short circuit, bypassing the feedback resistor Rf. This results the gain is decreasing linearly at a rate of minus 20 dB per decade. And at one particular frequency, the gain of the integrator will be equal to 0 dB. Let's say 0 dB frequency as F0. We can write F0 as 1 by 2 pi R into Cf. So, for proper integration, the input signal frequency should be in between cutoff frequency FL and 0 dB frequency F0. We can go beyond this 0 dB frequency, but we will find attenuation in output signal. It is sometimes necessary to reset the op-amp integrator to 0. The reset can be accomplished by simply adding a switch across the feedback capacitor. This switch has the effect of discharging the capacitor and thereby resetting the overall integrator. The reset switch can be a simple mechanical switch or semiconductor switch. The reset switches are typically FET based switches because they have a very high off resistance and can be controlled as switches in this type of applications more easily. This reset function enables the accurate integration of input signal. Now let's solve some examples on integrator circuits. Find out the output voltage for the integrator circuit shown in this figure. Here input is a square wave pulse. The output voltage of this circuit Vout equal to minus 1 divided by RCF integration of Vin dt. Here RC equal to 100 kilo ohm multiplied by 10 microfarad. That gives 1 second. Therefore Vout equal to minus integration of Vin dt. When input voltage to an integrator is constant, the output is a linear ramp. Therefore, the integration of the square wave results a triangular wave. Since the input to the integrator is applied to the inverting input, the output will be 180 degrees out of phase with the input. Thus, during the first off cycle of the input signal, the output will be a negative ramp. The second off cycle is negative. The output will be a positive ramp and the output waveform appears like this for this input square wave pulse. Determine the lower frequency limit or critical frequency for the integrator circuit shown in this figure. The critical frequency for the integrator circuit shown in the figure is given by FL equal to 1 by 2 pi RF into CF. Here RF is 100 kilo ohm, that equal to 10 to the power of 5 ohms, and C is 0.01 microfarad, that equal to 0.01 multiplied by 10 to the power of 6 farad. Therefore FL equal to 1 divided by 3.14 multiplied by 10 to the power of 5 multiplied by 0.01 into 10 to the power of minus 6. That gives 159 Hz as cutoff frequency. So the input signal frequency should be higher than 159 Hz. Determine the rate of change of the output voltage in response to a single pulse input to an integrator circuit shown in this figure. Here output voltage Vout equal to minus 1 upon RCF integration of Vin dt. Therefore the rate of change of output voltage is delta Vout by dt, that equal to minus Vin by RCF. Let's insert the values. That equal to minus 5 volt divided by 10 kilo ohm multiplied by 0.01 microfarad. That gives minus 50 kilovolt per second. You can write it as minus 50 millivolt per microsecond. The rate of change of output voltage is minus 50 millivolt per microsecond. When the input is plus 5 volt, the output is negative going ramp at the rate of minus 50 millivolt per microsecond. When the input is 0 volt, the output is constant level. In 100 microseconds, the output voltage decreases. Therefore, we can write delta V out as minus V in by RCF multiplied by dt. That equal to minus 50 millivolt per microsecond multiplied by 100 microsecond. That results minus 5 volt. Therefore, the negative going ramp reaches minus 5 volt at the end of the input pulse. That is after 100 microseconds from the initial condition. The output voltage remains constant at minus 5 volt for the time the input is 0 volt. The response to a single pulse input to the integrator looks like this. If next input pulse is a negative pulse, then the output reaches to 0 volt in another 100 microseconds. For the integrator circuit shown in figure, how long does it take for the output to reach saturation? Output voltage Vout equal to minus 1 divided by RCF integration of Vin dt. Since the input voltage Vin is 10 millivolt is constant, therefore Vout equal to minus 1 divided by RCF multiplied by Vin t. Let's insert the values in the equation. That equals to minus 1 divided by 10 kilo ohm multiplied by 0.2 microfarad multiplied by 10 millivolt input with respect to time. That gives Vout as minus 5 volts. Here the supply voltage is plus or minus 15 volt. So the time required for the saturation T equal to supply voltage divided by minus 5. That equal to minus 15 divided by minus 5. That gives 3 seconds. So in 3 seconds, the 10 millivolt input makes this integrate saturate. That's all about op-amp as integrator. So if you have any doubts, please do mention them in the comment section below. Thanks for watching this video. If you have learned from this video, please click the like button. Help others to learn by sharing this video. Please subscribe my YouTube channel and turn on notifications for more such videos. My next video is op-amp as differentiator. Have a nice day.